Hello everyone, Miss Carrie here from Miss Carrie's Creations. Welcome back to my craft space. Today we're going to take a look at paper, cardstock, and stamp organization. If you haven't had a chance to take a look at my craft room, we're just going to take a quick pan around the room. We have already taken a look at my Cricut and die cut organization system, and I have also shown you my desktop workspace, where I work as a maker, where I create my projects, and where and how I record my videos and live classes. If you have missed the first two craft room tour videos, I will put links to those in the description below. So today we're going to take a look at my paper organization. Most of my cardstock and paper sit on the shelf that my husband built for me to match my craft desk. As you can see, this sits in a corner of my craft room. It's about 3 or 4 feet away from the front of my craft desk. Not only do I have paper on this, but I also have a couple of items stored on the other shelves and on the top. The pattern paper that I store on these shelves is considered retired paper. I showed you in my first video how I store current papers on my desk. These are the papers that I'm using for classes or workshops or for projects I'm creating for my blog. I like to separate the retired from the current papers so that I don't accidentally show a paper pattern in a live video or in a class that somebody is unable to purchase from my website. I keep all of my cardstock colors, my patterned papers, and most of my specialty papers in these hard plastic paper handler boxes. When my husband built this shelf for me, I specifically asked that he build the shelves to hold these plastic boxes. Not only do they hold quite a bit of paper and cardstock, they're also very durable and they're designed to be able to travel. So let's first go ahead and take a look at the boxes that hold my cardstock. As you can see, they are in Roy G. Biv order. Let me go ahead and pull off one of these boxes from the shelf so we can take a closer look at it. Like I said, these are plastic paper handler boxes. These have handles that pull up to help you transport the boxes from one place to another. The handles tuck right back inside when I go to put them back on the shelf. In between each cardstock color is a tabbed divider envelope. Each one of the tabs is labeled with the cardstock color, and inside the envelope are some cardstock scraps in that color. This makes it really easy to find a piece of cardstock when I need one for a small Cricut project or when I'm making a paper crafting project. This is my pink and red box. I have a labeled envelope in between each color, so all I have to do is sort through and grab either a paper scrap or a full sheet of cardstock. This also makes cleanup really easy. When I'm done with a project, all I have to do is put the cardstock scraps in each one of those envelopes. On the shelves below my cardstock are some labeled bins that hold retired patterned paper. Each of these boxes has a label on it that corresponds to a specific theme. Now, if you remember in my very first video, I showed you all of my paper samples that were hanging above my desk. Each one of these paper samples also has a little tag that has that theme on it. So when I'm creating a project, I don't need to dig through these big bins. I just need to pull down my little paper sample ring and find the pattern paper that I want to use on a project. This also comes in handy when I am planning layouts for either retreats or for future videos. I just pull down those paper samples, I grab all of the papers that I'm going to need, the cardstock colors that I'm going to need, and the photos, and they all go in this envelope. Now, one thing I did not show you when I do my layout planning were these little layout planning cards. I do have some cards in the back that are from Simple Scrapbooker. These were printed probably 25 years ago. The ones that are in the front are my own creation. All I have to do is fill out the card, draw out some ideas, write down some journaling notes, and then everything goes right inside that little layout planning pack, and it gets stored away for future creating. On the very bottom shelf, I have three boxes that are not labeled. One is a more recent box that I just haven't created a label for. It holds mix-ins. The second one is retired cardstock colors that I hold onto. And the third one holds specialty paper. This specialty paper box also has a couple of different dividers. Between each one of the glitter cardstock colors, I have another one of those tabbed envelopes. This holds the glitter paper scraps. I have my glitter cardstock divided up by color in the front of this plastic bin. Now in the back, I have two plastic envelopes, one that holds metallic papers and holographic papers. The other one holds vellum and acetate sheets. Now I chose to put the holographic papers, metallic papers, vellum, and acetate in the two envelopes so that they didn't get scratched by the glitter cardstock, and it also keeps the vellum from getting wrinkled. In the very back of the box, I have some mixed media paper and a few 12 by 12 sheets of watercolor paper. Almost all of the specialty paper that I have goes in this box. I do have another place in my craft room where I keep smaller pieces of mixed media paper. In the drawer, I keep different distress watercolor papers, I keep some mixed media papers, and I keep some of my watercolor cardstock. These smaller papers go inside the drawer of an easel that I salvaged from the trash. Now I'm going to talk a little bit more about this easel and some of the other items in my mixed media collection in my next video. Recently, I have become rather fond of 6x6 patterned papers. These sit up on a shelf in this little wooden bin, which just fits these papers perfectly. I'm able to place them all inside here, and it goes right up on my shelf above my desk. Now, what about those patterned paper scraps? Many of you got a peek of this in my last video. This is a 12 by 12 iris bin that holds all of my paper scraps. My paper scraps are divided by type and size in memory protectors. I have used a paper trimmer to cut off where the holes are on the memory protector so it fits inside the box. This first 12 by 12 memory protector holds all of my zip strips or product strips. The next one holds textured cardstock, cardstock I have dry embossed, or cardstock I have created into backgrounds. The next set of memory protectors are designed for pocket albums. So I have some that are supposed to hold 6x4 photos and others that are supposed to hold 3x4 photos. I'm using them to hold smaller paper scraps. At this time, these are not divided by collection or color. They're just popped inside the pockets. Someday in the future, I will have these a little bit more organized. The next set of scraps is in a 12x12 memory protector. These are scraps that are too large for the pocket memory protectors, but they aren't quite a 12x12 size. The last set of memory protectors holds 12-inch strips. I like to divide up the smaller strips from the 12-inch strips because sometimes I'm needing a full piece of paper that's exactly 12 inches for maybe a border or for an entire scrapbook page. So I like to keep these two sizes of scraps separate from each other. Now this may seem a little bit over organized, and this is where you're going to see my OCD come out, but it does make it easier for me to find a specific size of paper scrap for a project that I'm working on. All right, so we've talked about the paper and the cardstock and the specialty paper. There's a few more things that I want to show you in relation to paper in my craft room. So last week we took a look at these four boxes. So last week I shared with you that the top box held all of my paper punches. Two of the other boxes hold flip-flaps and card bases. Let me go ahead and show those to you. In the box marked family, I have all of my flip-flaps and my photo place cards. You can see I have them organized by size. The smaller ones go in a little bin right next to the larger ones. And these go all the way up to the 5x7 size of flip-flap. If you don't know what a flip-flap is, I will put a link to a video above for you, and I'm going to be posting a new video next week showing how these work. In the box marked crafts, I have all of my card bases. So you're going to see some standard size card bases in here and envelopes. There's more of these because this is the primary card that I create. I also have some slimline card bases in here and envelopes and some 5x7 cards. I also have some little envelopes there in the back that I use occasionally. In the last video, I talked about how I like to keep like things together, and this is a primary example of that. So you might be wondering where I keep my extra memory protectors and the larger flip-flaps. In my closet, I have a wooden bin that sits upon a shelf. I'm going to go ahead and pull it off so we can take a look inside. This is a wooden magazine or newspaper holder that I found at a thrift shop for a dollar. Inside, I have folders, and each folder is labeled with the type of memory protector it holds. Now, I made these labels in Microsoft Word. I just created the label template. I typed up the name of the memory protector, and then I took a picture from the website and popped it in on the label. Now, I can never remember what these memory protectors look like, so having a visual reference is very helpful. In this bin, I have everyday life memory protectors, the larger flip-flaps, the pocket page protectors, and my top-loading memory protectors. Having them all labeled makes it so much easier to find the memory protector that I need, and they store neatly inside my closet. On the top shelf, I have paper page kits. Now, this is one portion of my craft room that is not very organized. I do have lots of page kits, way more than I need, and my next job is to go through all these page kits and decide which parts and pieces I want and which ones I plan on getting rid of. All right, now that I've shown you a couple of paper organization ideas, let me show you how I organize my acrylic stamps. So above my desk on the right side are four boxes. These hold all of my acrylic stamps. These boxes sit upon what used to be fry baskets. They belonged to a kitchen in the school and they were being tossed out. My husband cleaned them up, he spray painted them, and he added some beautiful white wood slats on the top and bottom. These look just like some shelves you would buy in the store for your home or craft room. Having the wood slats on the top gives me a space to be able to put a couple of collectibles and my Bluetooth speaker. So these cardboard boxes can be found at just about any craft store. I did decorate them a little using some Tim Holtz brass labels, and then I stamped onto some cardstock and tucked it behind the label to give it that old world look. So here's a quick close-up view of that label once again. It was really easy to create with some script stamps, some espresso ink, and then I just glued the labels right onto the box. In this box, I have all of my D size stamps. I have four boxes, one for A, B, and C, one for D, one for alphabets, and one for current stamps. Each time I buy a new stamp, it goes in my current stamp box. At the end of a season, I decide whether or not I'm keeping it. If I keep it, I have to get rid of another stamp set before it can go in a box. I only keep stamps that I plan on using multiple times, and once I've decided to keep them, they go into Evernote for cataloging. So let me give you a quick overview of Evernote. This is the home page. You can choose preferences like dark mode or light mode. You can also show recent notes, and that's the one that I like to have checked. Over on the left side, there's a couple of different menu options, and we're going to talk about a few of those here in a minute. What I want to show you is how I catalog my stamps. So I catalog these in what is called notes. So we're going to go ahead and click New, and we're going to click Note. Each one of my stamps is considered a note. And I add all of the information I need about a particular stamp in this note. Evernote has certain search features which will help me find specific stamp sets. So I always start out with the product number for the stamp, and I also add the title. This helps me to look up different ideas online, and it also helps me to keep track of the stamps that I own. Now, I also like to add an image to my stamp set, and I also like to check to see if it is a retired stamp set. So I always head over to my website. I'll type in a name in the search bar, or I'll type in the number for this stamp set, and I'll check and see if it's still available. If it's no longer available, then I will search for the image on Google. So if I forgot to save it when I first purchased the stamp set, I can go to Google, type in CTMH and the product number. I just go ahead and save that image in my downloads, and that way I can bring up that image later into Evernote. Okay, so we're back into Evernote. I'm going to go ahead and type in retired in capital letters so that I know this is a retired stamp set. And then I'm going to type in any of the sentiments that are on the stamp set. When I go into the search bar and type in words like surprise or slide or fancy, it's going to be able to find these words that I've typed as the sentiments. Now you can make changes to all of the fonts with these font options above if you want to. I usually just leave it as is and I don't bother with any of that. I do like to add a picture of my stamp. So I've gone ahead and clicked on the plus sign, and then I clicked photo, and now I can insert a photo of the stamp set. Sometimes I need to edit the photo. You can also click on those three little dots above the photo and rename it or do a full screen preview. I'm just going to click that little pencil so that I can crop this image. This is just going to take away some of that excess white space so that all I see is the stamped images. Now there are some other editing options over there on the left. I'm not going to mess with any of those today, but it's always nice to have options. I'm going to go ahead and click crop, and then I'm going to click save, and now my photo has been cropped for my note. Now, if I want to reduce it, I can go down to the sizing handle and make it a little bit smaller just so that I can see everything in one note. And now all I need to do is add some tags. Now, I do not have the paid version of Evernote. The paid version of Evernote can recognize images and find them when you are searching. Since I have the free version of Evernote, I type in the names of the shapes or the designs in my tags. I'll also add things like interactive card, encouragement sentiments, or even if it has some matching thin cut dies. Now, if you forget what types of tags you've added in the past, you can go over on the left side in the menu, click that down arrow next to tags, and see all of the tags you've used previously. Let's go ahead and take a look at the home page once again. You can see all of my recent notes there. I'm going to go ahead and search for a Christmas image. So I've gone into the search bar and I've typed Christmas, and now you can see all of the stamps that I have that either have the tag Christmas or they have a sentiment with the word Christmas in it. I can also search by just clicking on one of the tags. So for example, I'm just going to click on the word apple blossom, and you can see that I have one stamp set with an apple blossom. I can also go down and click on another one that says Bible verse, and now I can see all of the stamps I have with a Bible verse. It is really easy to search for the stamp sentiments and the stamped images in Evernote. Now you also have the option to create various notebooks. I have one notebook called Stamps, but I could add some new notebooks for paper collections or kits or inks or anything else that I want to record in Evernote. Like I said, I have the free version of Evernote, and I'll put a link to that in the description below, but there are some paid options available. I want to thank you again for joining me today in my craft space. I hope that I have given you a few ideas for organizing your own craft room or craft desk. Over the past few weeks, we've taken a look at my desk space, we've taken a look at my Cricut space, and today we took a look at where I store my paper, my cardstock, and my stamps. Next week, I'll be sharing the area where I store my mixed media materials. I'll be sharing how I organize my embellishments, and I'll be showing you where I store those random craft items. I hope that you've enjoyed all of these little videos in my craft room series. I hope that by breaking them down, you were able to watch a few of them and gather a few ideas for your own craft space. If you missed any of the past craft room tour videos, you can go ahead and click on that collection icon above. While you're at it, go ahead and click that subscribe button so that you don't miss out on any of my future videos. I hope that you have a wonderful week. I can't wait to see what you create.